Welcome back. Now we're going to talk about how predator-prey interactions have effects at community levels right across the ecosystem. And we're going to start by looking at the effects of herbivores on algae. Now, what we're looking at here is a parrotfish that's cruising around the reef. And I need to distinguish two types of algae. First of all, there's the little turfs, and these are a range of different algal species that it's feeding on, and they only ever get to about this kind of size, you know, 2 or 3 millimeters in height. And that's its main food source. But also there are seaweeds or fleshy algae, which grow a lot larger than 2 millimeters. And these are like any plant trying to start their life anchored to the reef and trying to grow up and form a big fleshy seaweed. Now, by virtue of the fact that this parrotfish is going around the reef and it's feeding intensively and mowing down these cropped algae, or these algal turfs we call them, it prevents the bigger seaweeds from getting established because they just get chopped off before they get a chance, which is directly analogous to if you were to stop mowing your lawn, then the weeds would eventually overgrow the system. And that activity, the fact that parrotfish here are keeping the reef in a neatly trimmed state of just fine algal turfs and preventing the seaweeds from really getting established, is actually very important. And what we can see is that if you look at the relationship between the amount of grazing, which might be the numbers of fish, and the amount of seaweeds or macroalgae living on that reef, it's a negative relationship. This is important because macroalgae are fierce competitors with small corals, and they can smother corals and preempt space for corals and do all sorts of things like that. So when we look at the effect of coral algal interactions and the important herbivores, we start seeing patterns emerging at the whole ecosystem. And there's a really nice way to illustrate this by revisiting the story of Jamaica from the 1970s onwards. Now, in Jamaica, even as early, it seems, as the 1970s, people have been fishing intensively for many, many decades. And in fact, if you were to swim in Jamaica in the 70s, perhaps you would have been surprised to see a fish maybe more than 15 centimeters in length. So there weren't a lot of big fish, but there were a lot of urchins. And urchins were playing the role of algal grazer and herbivore, and they were grazing everything down. Now, in the 1970s, coral cover was actually very high, something like 60% or more. And this is because those reefs hadn't been interrupted or disturbed by a major hurricane for nearly 40 years. So the reefs looked beautiful from a coral perspective. You couldn't see very many fish. In 1980, a very large hurricane came along, which happens from time to time, and it smashed up the reef and reduced the amount of living coral, just as you would expect it to. This was then followed by a period of coral recovery. But then in 1983, a really dramatic thing happened. At the Caribbean entrance of the Panama Canal, people started noticing that the long-spined sea urchins were dying. And within 1 year, almost all of the long-spined urchins died throughout the entire Caribbean. And that had an enormous impact, because now all that was left to do the grazing, the only major herbivore that was left in Jamaica were the fish, and the fish were really very small. And when that happened, the ability of these corals to start to grow was going to be impeded. And so the reef was then hit a bit more by some hurricane activity. It began to continue to decline. And the reason for that is because the fleshy algae, the seaweeds, had increased because they were no longer being controlled by herbivores, whether there weren't enough fish there for them, and the urchins had been removed by disease. And so this led to a fundamental change in the appearance of those reefs in Jamaica. They went from beautiful coral gardens to something that was really rather flat and dominated by big fleshy seaweed. We can think about this more generally when we think of phase shifts. And a phase shift is a term we give to a fundamental change in the community structure of an ecosystem. And we can think here of two different alternatives. Ideally, we'd be in the coral-dominated state, so there's lots of coral. The alternative is we could end up with a reef covered in seaweed, or an algal-dominated state. And we can imagine this as a kind of seesaw with a fulcrum. And ideally, you want the heavy end of the seesaw to be the one with the corals. Now, processes like storms, as we've seen, and also coral bleaching events, tend to push the coral cover down towards the algal sort of end of the spectrum. And that will tend to sort of level things, perhaps. But then the processes of natural recovery should help the coral cover increase again and restore the ecosystem. And in a normal set of circumstances, that's what would happen. Now, the problem happens is when we have added stresses to the ecosystem. So we talked in this last example about the stresses of fishing on parrotfish and then the disease of the urchins. But we can also add nutrients to that story. And we'll be talking more about nutrients in the lecture on local disturbances to coral reefs. And what that effectively does is moves the position of the fulcrum here towards the left, making it much easier for the coral state to flip into the algal state, which is really where we don't want the system to go. And so many of the objectives of coral reef management are to try and manage the system to push that fulcrum further and further to the right. And I'm illustrating this just to point out that much of what we understand about predator-prey interactions and how that affects communities actually does fundamentally influence the way that we try to manage coral reefs and keep them healthy. One of the key concepts that emerged when people started studying predator-prey interactions was the idea of a keystone species. And this was originally coined by Bob Payne. And the idea is that there are some species that have a disproportionately big impact on the ecosystem, even though they're not really very abundant. And we've just seen an example when we looked at the urchins, but here's another. This is the bumphead parrotfish again. They aren't very numerous on a reef, but they have a very large impact. And as we've seen, removing the keystone species can lead to a very large impact on the ecosystem. Now, so far, we've really focused on the direct effects of predators on their prey, you know, trying to eat them. But in fact, many would argue that some of the most important impacts of predators on their prey are affecting their behavior, effectively scaring them to death. And so many of the things that happen in ecosystems are result of the prey being terrified of the predator, and that the prey has to spend much of its time looking around for the predator. And whilst it's doing that, and whilst it's hiding, it doesn't feed. It might feed less, it might grow less, it might be more vulnerable to predators, it might not reproduce so successfully. So the effect of fear on prey can be really very important. Okay, so we can make the point then that predators don't just affect their prey through direct consumption, they also affect them through changing the behavior of the prey. And here's an example. Let's imagine a situation now where we have at the top some large predators. These are large groupers. These are an important predator. There's also a smaller predator hiding away in that coral. That's the coral trout looking fish that's just in amongst the coral there. And then we can see a few small parrotfish, which are the prey item of the smaller predator here. Now, in this situation, the smaller grouper, which is the one that's hiding, is hiding from the big predator. And therefore the chances that this smaller predator is going to manage to get out from its hiding place and catch these prey is relatively low because there's lots of predators around. Now let's imagine that humans came along and we took out some of those bigger predators. And what we have now is the prey is still cruising around, but now it's much more likely that that smaller predator is going to feel empowered to go out and spend more time foraging, looking for prey. It might be more successful and it'll take off. And this is something that really happens in ecosystems. And we call this trophic cascades, where an effect at one part of the food web cascades to affect other parts of the food web. And here's an example of some work that we did in Belize, which shows just such a trophic cascade on a coral reef. So again, we have our large groupers, which are a top or high level predator at least. Then there's some mesopredators or smaller, medium-sized predators, and then their prey, which are the damselfish, which we've seen before at the bottom. Now, in the 1980s and 1990s, in Belize, the numbers of top predators here, the grouper, were fairly abundant. I mean, they were still lower than they ideally should be because there was a fishery for them, but they were still pretty common. A few years later, in the early parts of 2000, by that point, humans had fished so many of these top predators that their numbers had become far more scarce. And as a result, there were fewer of the large grouper. That meant that more of the mesopredators could grow and forage freely, and as a result, the numbers of their prey declined. And so we have a fundamental change in the way the ecosystem is structured. So we're talking about food webs, we're looking at human impacts on food webs, and fundamentally, the actions that we have can cascade through entire food webs and change what's out there on reefs and how we will then value what's left. Typically, we might end up with an ecosystem that might be very different from what it looked like before humans came along and had some kind of impact of their own.